Good morning, everybody. I think we are quite lucky today to have around the table the equivalent of three generations of people working in media art, which is not very banal. And it will be a good way, probably, to explore the diversity of the practices and to see how, like in a history of painting, people have been doing abstract painting, conceptual painting, realist painting, hyper-realist painting, and surrealist painting, and whatever. In the field of new media, with a very diverse approaches, we have exactly the same level of diversity, and our panelists will probably demonstrate how complex, rich, diverse these practices can be. So, I will start asking Petra to introduce herself and tell a few words about your work. I have to say that Petra is coming from California, and she will tell us about her work.
Thanks for having me. My name is Petra Cortright. I am an artist based in Los Angeles. I'm from California. I'm from Santa Barbara. I'm 30. I was born in 1986. I got the internet when I was 10. So early childhood, I remember no internet. But now, yeah, I mean, most of making art, I've always had the internet as a resource. I've always loved computers. It's always been very natural to work on computers. When I was little, I realized that I could do much more sophisticated things on a computer than I could with my own hands. What else? I make videos, I make paintings, but they're digital paintings. Everything is on the computer. I take a lot of work from a lot of source images from online. I download a lot of software. I think that's a good way to start.
Okay, Petra, we'll go deeper into your work.
Okay, cool.
Now let's ask KyungHwa, who comes from Korea, with artist and director, and also in charge of international affairs of the Society of Korean Art Theory, and also from Los Angeles as well. So can you please introduce yourself and tell us about your work?
Thank you so much for introduction, really kind. Hi, everyone. I'm really truly happy to be here. I hope everyone can understand my English. I guess because my husband cannot. because my English is not that good. But I'll try my best. And my name is KyungHwa Lee. I'm an artist from Korea, Seoul. And I practice both in Korea and U.S. And I studied, I'll tell you a little bit of myself background. I studied architecture at Harvard, and I studied fashion design, Parsons School of Design, and Yihua Women's University. So my work is about the architecture of the body. I use 3D printing technology and virtual reality to achieve an architecturalization of the human body by scanning a person's form and turning it into digital code. So basically, it's like a DNA on my computer. So this code allows us to manipulate the body within a virtual space through a design process, working from a blueprint of ideal form. So I mean, just like architecture process, I make it. And then we can print out the result to materialize the idealization. I often generate the exaggerated body parts such as a bicep and breast, abdomen and legs that people commonly idealize in contemporary society. So I brought something today I want to show you, everyone. The, this is my work. This is 3D printed body work. It's obviously a female breast. People idealize this kind of body. So since I got this one, I think somebody got to try this one. So, Petra? I think you have a perfect body already. So I guess, Maurice?
What you want? No, no problem. I don't know if it fits with the jacket.
You don't have to open, hold on. I'm not sure that matches with you. I guess. Thank you. So wonderful. You look just fine. Fantastic.
I look proud.
Thank you. Thank you. You can put it down. So I attach these 3D printouts to people's body to reify the concept and allow each subject to embody the plasticity of physical transformation. So people can experience it and enjoy it and touch it. And then so this is like the idea of embodiment. So in the future, every person will choose their body as a fashion, as today we choose and change clothing. That's what I think. That's my work.
Thank you, KyungHwa. Now we're going to ask Link to talk about his work and his background. Link is from Beijing. I think he has been a student at GAFA.
Sorry, my language have some problem because I can't speak English, but I say 普通话. Give me 广东话. I can't. So,我只能用中文去说，我实际上我是想成为一个画家，然后到一个 美术学院去学习，但是在学校的时候，我学习的是一些新媒体的艺术语言，就像是行为表演，或者说是电脑的技术，或者说是那个一些计算机的一些技术。然后呢，然后最后我开始使用电脑来成为我的一个工作室，就是我在电脑上面用界面或者用自拍的一些 一些方法，或者是用制作录像的一些技术，然后去制作我的作品。然后我同时也通过电脑去网上看艺术作品，然后我也会看到 Petra 的作品，然后我也会看到 Petra 的作品，然后我会看到世界范围里面的一些艺术家的作品。就我一待在一个房间里面，我也可以感受到这个世界的艺术在跟我一起。这些就是我制作的一些表演，就像是这是我在屏幕上弹奏钢琴，但其实是在敲击我的键盘。然后这个是我电脑里的这些数据。
So here you can see data in my computer. These are virtual data.
然后可以把它们放在一个实体的空间里面，
they can be placed in a physical space. So it's like being opened in a real space. These are photos of performance, and I sit in front of my computer to work. Thank you. This is my publication, and all the books can be scanned out, and you can see the video.
Thank you, Link. At the beginning of it, we didn't have the translation, but it came after. So now I think it's okay. And now I'm going to ask Masaki Fujihata, who has been for a while working on the University of Tokyo as a professor, and now a guest professor at Linz Art University. And please, Masaki, you know, we are let's say, on the same generation. And
sorry.
So you're a pioneer in the field of media art, and you're probably one of the very first to have been using VR combined with GPS in the early 90s. So please tell us about your background and your practice.
Thank you for introducing me. And I'm really happy to have a chance to talk with you here in Basel. It is quite a different type of a place for me. And my career is quite long because I started my early, you know, moment to face with the technology was started in 80s with the computer graphics. So the SIGGRAPH is the main place I've been showing my piece there. But after that, you know, my, you know, main objective is to is the technology itself. So technology is, you know, invisible, and it's very common, but invisible. And it's just a rational way to use, like internet, people can communicate in a different way from a telephone and a television and so on. That's a kind of curiosity to me, to make new media instead of industry made. So for me, you know, my task, maybe I should say, my task is about to liberate technology from capitalism. So because there are a lot of, you know, possibility inside the technology, but usually which is not invisible. So maybe you can see some slides there. Not, this is not mine, but I just show my capture several of images about my project using GPS. So in the year 1992, I knew that the GPS, this is a very, very early moment. Now the GPS is very common. Your smartphone is already embedded. But in the 90s, the car navigation system is the consumer product. But I brought the GPS to climb up Mount Fuji, trace the shape of Mount Fuji. And then I recognized that it's interesting to attach video with the GPS. So then this is a kind of initialization in early 90s, and still I continue to use this, you know, way of combining different technologies. And maybe I should say a little bit more, because yeah, this is the kind of slides. I did it in the UK. With public people participation. This is another one in Japan using the lake, combining the video and this is another one. I made an interview on the border between France and Germany, and this is in the Northern Islands. I did so many different projects using same technologies because, you know, GPS was invented as a weapon, a part of a weapon. It's an army use. But now I try to use this technology in peace. And then this is a book I published last year in Paris. And this is an archive of myself. And you can see all of my projects by using the augmented reality.
Can I?
So the last project I did was in France. Very stable.
Hold your microphone.
Yeah.
Ooh. I'm not sure people will get the image.
Yeah. But anyway. It's a bit difficult to show you, but anyway, I'm always curious about to use a new technology in a different way to connect the meaning of the technology and the meaning of the communication between me and the audience and also the participants. So, sorry, I think it's a quick. It's a bit long, but
we will come back. We will come back to your case. But I think it's very interesting the fact that you have been introducing the body inside the artwork, like in the history of art, the representation of space and the body in the space was a big challenge. And in a way, we know that Pollock has been trying to consider that the painting was a result of the experience of the body, and you experience the motion of the body in space, becoming, creating the very specific artwork and a very specific art space. So I will ask KyungHwa to say about her experience of the body in virtual reality and through performance.
Okay, my body, in my work, the body is the key thing. And I deal the body as architecture and looking at it as a fashion. I had this installation and performance art show at MMCA National Museum in Korea, in 2015. This whole performance is about the transformation of the logical progression of the body in different dimensional space. If you saw my image from the slide, I wish my slide is up there, but it's like, I think it's Petra's image is here.
That's virtuality.
Okay. So there was a huge black box image. I call it apparatus. And audience enters the apparatus space. This space scan the body. And the idea is body becomes an informational code. And one-dimensional coding from the audience body data becomes two-dimensional flat shadow and photography. And three-dimensional patterned body shows the appearance of the world and goes into four-dimensional virtual space as the manipulated body with the architectural process of idea form. And then finally, we can print out the body and where it becomes, you know, part of the body. So the reason why I brought this, you know, the female, this breast 3D printed body, because it's the idea of this artist's mind becomes a material, and this material instantiation of the idea. So I think it's the, we are at the beginning of a new artistic epoch. That we have progressed the work of art, mechanical reproduction, but now we have arrived at the age of mechanical materialization. So my body is the idea of this significance of shaping the body as a traditional corset versus 3D printing technology today. So body is, you know, meaning as a architecture and in art.
Thank you, KyungHwa. I will keep on asking Petra on your left. Petra, it seems that all your work is about your body on stage, but your stage is home, actually. So can you tell us about your very specific practice in relation with what we could call social media art?
It's funny because the videos, I've gone to great lengths to make it not about me. I love working with the software. I have so much fun doing it, and I work very much alone, so I don't like working with a lot of heavy equipment or anything. Like, I like when I'm in control of everything, and so that's why I got really interested in webcams. And the videos, the slides that you'll see, I work with these softwares that it's like live effects. So basically, if you move your hand, it'll have like fire behind it or something. Like, there's a slide of that. And so it'll just kind of react to your body. But what I love about webcams is I love low quality. I don't like high definition. I don't want to show every pore. It's like, I like, webcams are like this veil. I think it's like a very, like, some of the older technologies are very beautiful to me. And so I actually try to make it not about me. But I like, because I like working alone so much, I'm my only subject, I guess. So I have to, I have to be in the videos. But it's interesting.
Petra. Actually, okay, you say it's not about your body, but of course we see the body 100% of the time.
Right.
But it may be something else. That's the only subject of your practice. I would like to know, as your work seems to be inspired by the practice of selfie, I would like to know if you have a specific relation with your public, with people watching your videos.
Yeah, I think I do. I've always thought of the work as more self-portrait rather than selfie. I know it gets put in that category a lot, but I think there is a difference. I think I always try to make the background, like the room is really important as well, as it's not just me, so it's like the whole composition. And so I've always thought of them more as a self-portrait, but because it is working with, like, I mean, I can't escape the fact that I'm a woman posting a picture or posting images of myself online. I mean, that it's heavy, like that comes with a lot of context. And so, yeah, like, there's a really interesting relationship that you have with the public when that's occurring. I've gotten some very interesting comments over the years.
Yes, just a few words about your public, how the public react. Do you have a specific relation with the public due to the fact that you're practicing social media as an art?
I'm always really interested, I'm much more interested in the negative comments rather than the positive ones. I think it's so interesting because anytime you have anyone's attention online, especially if they're really taking time to leave a comment, I mean, most people just, like, the worst that can happen is you can just click through and not engage with anything. But if people are really taking the time to comment, and especially, like, negatively, you know you're onto something.
Some examples?
Ooh, I don't know if we want to go there.
What can they say negative? What kind of negative comments?
I mean, like, a really mild one is like, oh, I just wasted 2 minutes of my life watching this video. But it's like almost like it takes 3 minutes to kind of think about that and then type it out. So it's so interesting to me. Like, yeah, but I used to have this policy where I would respond. I got really into the vernacular of the way that people talk to each other online. And a few years ago on YouTube, like when YouTube, it's different now. Like social media, they're always changing. Like the vernacular is always changing. But like a few years ago, it was kind of rough and people would say some really mean stuff. And I used to reply like equal to or greater than what they said to me. So it would be these really, I'd say, like, type out these really horrible things that I could never even say out loud, but it was just kind of this, like, just this response. Because it just was appropriate. I don't know. I'm really interested. I like trolling. It's kind of interesting to get into.
Thank you. Thank you, Petra. I would like to ask Link, do you have the translation now? Okay. So, Link, you tell us that your studio, your computer is your studio. So you put yourself inside the computer, inside the interface. Can you tell us more about this specific relation with your computer?
The relationship with my computer is more like it's like an eye or hand. It's like an extension of my body parts. And as a matter of fact, I just like painting. So I, swifted my passion in painting to some of the experiences that I had with my computer, and such experiences, is that the computer becomes part of my hands, my feelings, and I would use it to record some of the observations that I had in daily life and make it an artistic work. And it may even be some of my imagination, and through my own way, I learned about art and to implement art and to test and probe with the various possibilities. And also through my own knowledge, I tried to create some work. However, on the internet, I also have seen Petra's work. And I feel that, what was just said, I actually deeply, you know, rapport with that. I agree with it a lot.
Thank you, Ling. I would like to ask Masaki. You have been working first on augmenting reality by introducing image in the physical space, thanks to GPS and so on. And now you want to augment images by adding images and images. Can you tell us about your experience in introducing augmented reality in a book?
For me, producing something is really an experimental thing. So there is no conclusion. So when we find out a new technology like augmented reality, I found it's interesting, yeah? And then why not, you know, I want to use it. Then I can find out another aspect, like you ask me, there is a lot of layers, because those videos and the 3D models inside my book is already, you know, how do you say, inside and inside and inside. So there's many, maybe five or six different layers. This is very interesting, attracts to me, because, you know, it's not the real object, but also you can have an imagination. So what is the relationship with the objects or your experience and the work? And then, you know, I think, you know, in those days, there are people, actually the A.D. Dooding is talking about the prototype. I think my work is completely on this line. I'm making a prototype, and then, you know, I can improve it, and, you know, prototype include something, you know, future. We don't know yet. So that's why I'm dealing with technology, because, you know, technology is already there, but we do not know what it is, you know. For example, like a computer we are using, also we are using internet, but you can imagine, you can remember in the 80s and 90s, so many people spend a lot of money to make a computer, but they lost a lot of money. That's why. Then I think, you know, they really want to know what is the computer. Still now we are using internet, still now we are using computer, but we really don't know for what we invented, just by inventing something, we can feel, we can experience, we can get something from this. I think that this technology came from somewhere from the heaven. We still don't know yet.
Thank you. As we are talking about motivation and the background of operation of computers or doing artworks, KyungHwa, could you please tell us about the philosophical implications of your work, as you have also a philosophy background?
Okay. I'm very much interested in philosophy for a long time. Philosophy to me is to be perceived, and I look at this, you know, phenomenology of this society, looking at it as a fashion, because it's this idea of a changeability, and then this influence by media, you know, in this, you know, contemporary world. I was some point influenced by media philosopher Willem Flusser. I adopted this idea of his apparatus concept. I started looking at this as a traditional corset idea. So it's the idea of, you know, like all the traditional shaping the body is kind of machine, this, you know, using this technology. So contemporary version is like 3D printing technology. So my work basically actually talks about the philosophy about freedom and power using technology to make us free. So everyone can create their own body. So it's about the new power to the artistic process, and that, you know, makes, you know, everybody equal. So this power is like a almost like truly a Promethean power, is like a godlike power, I'll say. because the discuss, you know, the idea of a kind of God creating completely new and inhabitable domains. By using this technology, by actualizing these technologies, we may declare we are gods. make our own body by using this, you know, technology. So I thought this is kind of a very interesting way of thinking. So I got philosophy from here.
Thank you. That's interesting because you, when you say we are gods thanks to technology, you say so we can make our own body. But in most philosophies and most history of religions, I don't know so many that include the fact that God makes his own body. Very often doesn't have anybody. But that's interesting, because I take this opportunity to ask Petra, what is a specific relation to special effects that looks like another kind of animism, let's say a kind of a God implication in the magic of producing extension of the body on screen. And I would like to know if your public is actually perceiving the irony of your work.
I actually don't think that, I don't think my work is ironic.
Okay. No, good.
It's actually, I'm a very sincere person, and I really just love what I do so much, and I love the way that I work, and it's very sincere, I think. I think a lot of work right now is, I mean, art can be so many things. It can be political, conceptual. I mean, there's so many things, and I think a while ago I made the decision that I just wanted to contribute something simple and hopefully something beautiful. So this is what I try to do in the work. But it's always like, yeah, because I work with technology, I think, yeah, it's just not as straightforward or something. It's harder to get across the simplicity sometimes. With the public and the special effects, I mean, I use a lot of things that other people have made. I love working with, I take so much software from the internet. I download a lot of things that other people have made. I really, because I'm not a programmer, I don't like programming. I don't like math. So it's just, you know, Photoshop is like, it's very, very powerful. It's, you know, programmed by geniuses. It's an incredible resource. And I love, so even just like the most simple basic tools in Photoshop, like I wanted to kind of see how I could use even the most basic things to start like making paintings or something or drawing. So initially when I first learn a program, I'll always try to start with the most basic tool and then see how I can push that to make something really as complex as possible and like make a whole painting out of just a one pixel pencil brush, which is what I used to do when I first learned Photoshop.
I think we perceive your challenge. Linka, I would like to ask you if in your work you refer to a primitive net artist who have been playing a lot with the interface, playing a lot with icons, and playing a lot with what you're using, actually. Do you refer to these artists in the, let's say, beginning of the 90s and of the 80s, who have been working a lot on their materiality and the specificity of the medium?
I don't know what were the circumstances in the 80s and 90s, because I was born only mid-80s, and when I started to use the computer,
not really in primary school, but in fact in secondary schools when I started to use computers. When I started to use computers and to have a relationship with the computers, as like a computer is an office tool, because at that time I don't need to work in an office. I am a child. I need to play. So I go up to I use the computer to play games and to serve and etc. So after a while, when I went into university, originally in art school, the classroom is like a computer bar. So all of these technologies and techniques that I learned about the computer, and I also at the same time have some likes of the computer that I've developed when I was a child. So I started to learn about computers and about Photoshop, and I also learned on my own some other software which was not in the curriculum. I just tried to understand what it is and use it to implement what I wanted to do.
So my question was related to something else, because it's a very big, important issue, which is what is the place of history of new media art in your training in the schools now that teach people, young artists, to practice with new media? I mean, do you have a kind of, because of course you're born in the middle of the 80s, but of course we are all born at a certain date, doesn't mean that we ignore the history of art before. So I would like to know if in your training you had a kind of perspective of history of media art.
As a matter of fact, I graduated from an earliest
new media discipline in China.
Everything to me was
so fresh, new, something that I have not even heard before I entered the school room. And after I learned about them, I started to learn about this multimedia functions around me. There are a lot of artists, Chinese artists and Chinese works, and I was able to see their work and learn about their information. So this is something that I learned at school. Of course, I have not, to understand new media, I just
learn
from
electronic
media festivals, and only in these activities was I exposed to the various forms of new media around the world. And also, as a matter of fact, when I graduated from the school, I also tried to learn about the internet, learn from the internet, in fact, because in at that time, that wall around China, it was not built. I could still access Google and various sites. So I saw that some people around this world was perhaps doing things that were similar to my concept. So I wasn't the only one. But nobody told me that whether this was new media or not. The concept of new media in our country was even was a concept that's related to communications, and it's another totally new concept, and all along it has not become a school of art. Now slowly but gradually it has become a mainstream category.
Thank you, Link. Maybe Masaki, you wanted to say something to add to
this
you. Point.
So for me, people are talking now new media and new media art, but for me, we can transform old media into a new media art. This is possible. Even we can use the pencils in a different way. So we can combine. For me, I'm using a GPS and a video camera. This is a kind of invention. But after I connected these, then I can, discover another interesting way to use. So this is a kind of, attitude against media. We do not have to care about which is new or old. This is a point. So sometimes, especially Japanese, you know, media artists always talking about the new, which one is the new media? I think it's a bit awful. So we have to, you know, see more, you know, far away, and to examine how can we transform the media into a new media. So that's my concern.
Yeah. Thank you, Masaki. I think I'm supposed also to give a talk, and nobody is here to ask me questions, but feel free, please, to ask me questions if you feel it.
Maurice should say something about the, about your idea of the media and the media art.
Yeah, that's an interesting question. Actually, it's true, we never talk about new media, but more about media art, and I even talk more often about open media art, which means the fact not to consider that it's about using computers, but using any kind of medium and feeling totally free to go from one to another according to what we want to say. So maybe I should say something about my background. I come from contemporary art school and in La Sorbonne in Paris. I started learning oil painting and any kind of techniques related to tradition. And very quickly, I've been working with video in the 80s, and I made video installations and made video works. And my concern was more at this time that I didn't find in the 80s the what was produced in the art world as very exciting. I had the feeling that the previous period has been very lucky because they had the possibility to reinvent art. And in the 80s, I didn't have the feeling that we were reinventing anything. People were very happy about, because of the postmodernism, to go backward and to do painting again and to do to redo the history of art, and this was just boring. And then I started to use computers at the end of the 80s, so very late for me compared to some of the digital natives here. And I made in the early 90s, I made one of the very first TV series made of computer graphics that was broadcast on TV. But it was actually a conceptual work, but my challenge was to make it display broadcast in prime time. And so I did Quarks, which is the very first TV series made of computer graphics. When I did that, everybody, because I got plenty of awards with that, everybody was convinced I would do animation. But the thing is that animation was not my thing, and immediately I started working with VR, with virtual reality. Yeah. And so I made a project of creating a collection of contemporary art made of VR, of virtual reality, asking artists to make projects for this collection. But it was a lot of work because I had to explain what it was to the artists, and I have to conceive the work for them. So I thought, okay, I should do my own VR works, and I started to do that. And in 95, I made a work in the Pompidou Center that connected the Pompidou Center with the Museum of Contemporary Art in Montreal. It was called The Tunnel Under the Atlantic. And I consider that the virtual material people would have to dig in should be the obstacle. And the obstacle was a cultural obstacle. So people had to dig in through that and took 5 days in order to meet. So they could see each other through the tunnel, they discover content and so on. So last year we had at the Osage Gallery an exhibition called Just Dig It, where we presented five different tunnels with different kind of obstacles, like the Borders Tunnel and the Colors Tunnel. You've seen that?
I think I want to say one thing, because we should think about the early period of the 20th century when the artist faced photography. Yeah, so I think the computer is a very, very similar situation like a photography. So after the photography came in, Impressionism and Mandai, we can see a very nice photography over there. So those are, you know, people who started to use. And another person, you know, against using photography. This is an attitude. There is two different type of attitudes that exist. And then, you know, why not? In my case, I really want to use it. What is this? I really want to know. So I think, you know, Mandai and the other people who started to use photography has the same attitude. When he is here, maybe, of course, he's using computer. I don't know. Those, you know, four, five people has a different attitude. This is good. This is really good.
I would like to go in your direction because photography help us to reconsider painting.
Yes.
Because photography arrived in the 19th century, people started to consider maybe painting is not about realism. It's not about just reproducing how the world reflects the light. Maybe it's something more, something else. And this is how the evolution of art history has been. So I did a work with photography, which was in 97, called World Skin, a photo safari in the land of war, and where people used to have photo cameras in the virtual world, totally under, surrounded by pictures of the Second World War and the Bosnia War. But when one make a picture, one they take is taken from the scene, erased, become white, and printed out. So they can live with the skin of the world, what they have taken, at the same time, the visuality of the image, but also the memory of the event.
That's just Marshall McLuhan said, the new technology always refer to the old technology. Yeah.
Often. Yeah? I just would like to finish with some other aspect. I will be short.
Sorry.
Because we have a time thing, so I'm just following the time frame.
Thank you.
After 2000, I started to work with what I call urban media art, and I did many works. Like you see here, this is an installation done in 2005 in China. That was in Penantin in Shanghai, Cosmopolis. This is another work, which is actually about the series. This one is New Horizon in Shanghai. It's an installation where I converted the citizens of Shanghai into flash codes. And then they become virtual reality because they become the buildings. So instead of hiding people, it's actually helping them to reappropriate the city. Mm. And you see some, this is just Zigit exhibition, so with skeletons of the tunnels. And this is the last work I've been working on, which is Brain Factory, where people use EEG, electroencephalography, in order to control matter. So they think about abstract concepts, human concepts, and they convert these concepts into shapes, creating a collection, a glossary of shapes that help people to reconsider what are human abstractions. And these shapes are then 3D printed. And this is a process of reification, which is for me the opposite, of course, of sublimation, which is the fact to convert,
Maurice.
The physical world into data.
Maurice, maybe you'd better talk more. I wanna have some reflection from Petra and other
sure,
people.
We yeah. still have the time, and just I minutes. Took care of the 10 minutes for each of us. That's how it works.
Yeah, I want to ask, you know, tell me just a short comment. What is the computer? What is the internet? I really want to know. Very difficult, but maybe you can say something.
Yeah, I think it's a difficult question. I think it means different things to everyone. But I just know my view about it. Ultimately, I'm a nerd. I think that I think everyone up here
You spend the whole day with the computer?
I've spent a lot of time on the computer. I think that we both have a very... Link and I both have a very like solitary and also celebratory feeling about like using computers and like how and thinking about that in what that means for painting, like desktops as paint. I've seen slides of his desktops, like really, really cool with all the icons and painting. And yeah, it's, yeah, I mean, I guess, yeah, celebratory. I love it.
To me, computer space is more about the place for the people's desire experience. And, you know, people create the reality within this, you know, space. So I think it's more about the extension of the space, you know, of our reality. So as I look at it very positive way to look at the space. And so we could have like even extension of our life there.
Yeah.
And also we could be free within that space. And then in my case, you know, like Maurice was doing this emotion printout, right? Those kind of, you know, usually it's unseen thing and you cannot touch it. And then you print out the result and we don't even know what it is like. But, you know, once you experience it, and then we could extend our, you know, word, I mean, better and more like experiential way and, you know, project this, you know, human being's desire to the reality.
Think of.
对，然后我是因为我主要是一个人在一个家里面，然后周围是农村，什么都没有。
Around me are the villages and there's no city life. However, with a computer, it's like a window that I can look through for the external world and also to have to send emails to work and to interact with the rest of the world. So you feel that you are with the rest of the world.
However,
I also have a video of me called Like Me. Its content is from Star Trek. It's a dialogue in Star Trek, which says roughly about a very distant constellation in the future that has a very high level of civilization. And when dream,
you know,
it's like a drug. When dream becomes reality, then
you will cease to travel.
You will cease to create. You will also, you know, cease to maintain those machines that your ancestors have left behind. You would just be sitting there like a dummy. I think technology is something that changes the world, and humans are part of it. Humans are also part of that evolution. We are in fact, you know, just trying to keep a historic moment. There's no other way for me. I can only record something of the current, you know, mind that I have right now.
I would like to ask, before we have the questions, I will ask Masaki if he would like to add a few words.
Yeah. So in my case, you know, I have been using computer from late 70s and 80s, and I started to use internet 1989. Then the moment we face Mosaic, it's the first web browser. So it was so amazing, so democratic, yeah? But now it's things, you know, upside down. It's a very bad, you know, the internet is not the good place now. So that's really, really, really sorry. So I really want to make something, you know, not like a Facebook, not like a Twitter, but the communication tool for democracy. I don't know, it's a dream. It's really a utopic idea, but I think that's my role.
Yeah, it's not the most positive words, but we agree that from a space of freedom, it has become a space
because
of surveillance.
It's out space now.
Yeah, we just have a few minutes for some questions. So if you have some questions to some of the speakers or the older speakers, please feel free to take the microphone and ask. No? We don't have time? Oh, I thought we had 10 minutes for the question. No.
No.
Oh, okay. Possible? Just one? Yes, please. Just one question.
Thank you.
Sorry for that.
Thank you. Thank you for your talks. And I have a question. Before I ask this question, I want to say we all know the growth of new media artists has been quite strong recently, in the last 10 years, actually. My question is, what do you guys think of the future of new media art in next 10 years? Would it be getting slower or even more radical? And I have a question for Lin Ke specifically. Recently, a young Chinese photographer, Ren Hang, who based in Beijing too, just committed suicide. What do you think of that? Thanks.
Lin, maybe you start with a...
就是关于这个城市中的生活的这种情况,
regarding the life in the city, well, I also live in Beijing, however, I live in a rather rural place, so my feeling for the city life would be less. However, I would go into the city and try to experience the city. I also feel pain and anxiety, and I would can only say that this is part of life, however, committing suicide. Well, we do see a lot of this in the society. This may be because of the social, of the new circumstances in the social media, that while changes our life, it also changes our desire, our expression, our mind, our thoughts, and our experiences. So I am rather pessimistic, you know, about this.
Okay, somebody with a positive, optimistic vision of the future for the 10 years? No, you don't have that.
I think this. We also refer to photography. So when Musée d'Orsay bought many films, then they opened the museums, then the photography started as an art object. This is a fact. I don't know what will happen in the future, but we have to invent how to conserve, how to keep the media art piece. But this must be happen. I believe it. Then some are very conservative, like me and you. We are going to be a very conservative artist, perhaps. I don't know, but...
I don't have a feeling to be conservative.
but anyway...
I would like my work to be conserved, but I don't want, conservative.
I'm just joking. Of course, there is another aspect, radicality, a radical way to use the technology, of course, must be exist. Those, possibility must be exist.
Okay.
Yeah.
So no more. You would like to say something, Petra?
Well, in terms of I guess I should specify my feelings about computers and software are very different than the feelings about the internet. It's very. I probably should have separated the two because, even 10 years ago, social media was very, very different than it is now. And I know that 10 years before that, it was very different as well. And the changes I've seen overall are not great. Everything has become incredibly commodified and censored. And it's very boring. That's very boring for art when this happens. So for the future, I would love to see things go back to more things like personal websites, where websites actually look different, where you didn't just use one template like Squarespace or something just to pop up something that looks like everything else. I would love to, what Masaki was saying about, it would be great to go back to the earlier days when there really was more free information, so...
we cannot promote that. We can say it, that's it. KyungHwa, last sentence, because I think we have been gone beyond the limits. Just one sentence.
Oh, okay. I think I already answered because I look at this, because my case, my new media artist is sort of different from everybody else. So I look at the more positive way of creating this new reality. And I believe it, and this, this 3D printing technology, what I use, is going to bring us more interesting future, and we could create even more interesting art in the future.
Thank you very much for these positive words. So thank you, all of you, for your contributions. I think we had a very exciting panorama of media practice in 2017. Goodbye, thank you. And thank you for the audience.